Building a service these days that unintentionally exposes millions of people's of user records or is otherwise insecure is unfortunately very easily done. And in today's talk, I'm going to look into who is going to be involved in a random company when that is happening and who is going to be involved in fixing that and the fallout from that. My name is Marcus Sautermann, as Mary mentioned. I work for Crate.io. We build a database for the IoT world. And I'm a member of the Django security team. Django is a web framework, open source web framework, that's used by companies like Instagram and Mozilla to build their web services. I want to start this talk with a short story. This is a picture of the RMS Titanic on April 10th, 1912, when it was leaving Southampton on its maiden voyage to New York City. It was the biggest ocean liner at that time, and there were 2,224 people on board. 4 days into the journey, this message made it to the captain, Edward Smith. Westbound steamers report bergs, growlers, and field ice. A few hours later, at 1:42 p.m., another message, similarly worded, made it to the captain. Greek steamer Athenia reports passing icebergs and large quantities of field ice. Now, the captain acknowledged both messages, so he was aware there was ice. But it wasn't particularly uncommon to see ice in that area in April, and it wasn't also not particularly people were thinking that icebergs weren't a particular risk to these big ocean liners. So he kept on going, and well, throughout the rest of the day, four more messages made it to the Titanic. At 1:45 p.m., America passed two large icebergs, three large bergs 5 miles southward of us. And at 9:40 p.m., ice report, so much heavy pack ice and great number of large icebergs. So these three messages never made it to the captain. The sixth and final message reached the Titanic at 11 p.m. from a ship called Californian, which stopped in the middle of the ice rather close by. However, the radio operator on duty at this point was still completely filled with tasks from a backlog from the day before, when there was an outage on the radio station. So instead of actually taking the message and responding properly, he went with, shut up, I'm working Cape Race. And Cape Race is a radio station onshore in Newfoundland. So at 11:30 p.m., that operator also went to bed. And then 10 minutes later, at 11:40 p.m., after sighting an iceberg right ahead, the Titanic hit its starboard. Over the next 2 hours and 40 minutes, more and more water made it into the hull of the Titanic. The Titanic sank at 2:20 a.m. on April 15, 1912, killing more than 1,500 people. Not as dramatic as that is receiving a notice of a possible security issue. At least usually, nobody's life is on the line, unless we're talking about, for example, hospitals. And support teams at companies, they need to sort through those messages on a daily basis. They need to triage them and figure out who to talk to and what to do with a message. And these messages can be a regular bug report, can be spam, can be a support request, can be a possible security issue. And when their triaging is off, this issue is just going to pile up next to all the other bugs until somebody starts working on it. But even when the message is correctly identified as a possible security threat, then, well, they need to pass on the message properly and accordingly to the current standards and processes they have in that company. So that can be a dedicated security team, or project managers, product owners, who knows. Product and project owners, they need to budget for our engineers to work on this issue. And they might even get a security team involved to do a bit more in-depth analysis of the issue. And when they realize, hey, this is an issue that we can quickly build, fix with a workaround that we can provide to customers, then, well, key account management or customer support is going to be involved again to talk to customers and get their system safe. But if it's a bit more issue, then developers need to come up with a security fix. And coming up with a security fix also implies there's going to be testing involved, so testers, quality assurance need to be involved. And when we have that, we have documentarians and technical writers who want to write something down and should write something down as well. And then this product needs to be shipped. So everybody else in this who's part of this release cycle or release procedures is going to be involved as well. Now, so far, most of those positions are commonly referred to as people in the engineering department. But looking at proprietary products, for example, well, there's customers who are still there that usually or often pay for updates. Do we going to charge them for this update, even though it's a security fix? Are we rolling it out for free? What is the SLA for that? How far are we going to backport possible security fixes? So these are things where product owners, sales department will need to talk about and chat and have and figure out what to do in these processes, in these situations. And imagine one of those leaks that exposed millions of people's of data records. That's a PR nightmare. So the public relations office will have their hands full, and the marketing department probably wants to also rethink the product slogan when that used to be the secure thingy. Because when you just had a security breach, that might not be the best slogan anymore. Now, furthermore, the legal department is going to be involved because, well, they need to talk to the authorities and have the data protection officers involved. And in case of a production company, well, if the bad press about the issue causes sales of a product to go down, well, then the purchasing department wants to reduce the number of purchased parts. Now, what do we learn from all these like parts in the company and departments that are involved? Well, while standards, requirements, guidelines, all these things are great and help a lot, they are also commonly inadequate, incorrect, and not necessarily up to date. At the time of when the Titanic sank, steamships or ships of that size had to carry 16 lifeboats. The Titanic had 20, which was great because that's above the requirements. But that were those 20 lifeboats were only sufficient for 1,178 people. Now, there was also a common understanding of these lifeboats to be used as a short-time vehicle to get people off the sinking ship onto another ship that was close by. Unfortunately, it was the middle of the night, so this wasn't really possible, and also nobody expected the Titanic to sink in 2 hours. And in today's world, just because a lot of companies still send mobile SMS with some tans for something, think this is a good idea, it's actually not, because it's not particularly secure. So maybe rethinking this approach is an option. And it's also been documented that a lot of crew members had no understanding of what the evacuation procedures were. And this is less of a communication issue in this particular case, but more of a lack of practice. There was a single trial run right before leaving shore. And even with Captain Smith having 40 years on the job, he was still completely paralyzed by the enormity of the problem. And translating this into the tech world means we need to train ourselves for incidents. And we need to do that regularly and not just write processes down. Because people act in all kinds of ways when they are under stress, and occasionally even irrationally. And lastly, and probably most importantly, communication is crucial. I mean, communication at a company is important in any case, and when you have a lot of departments involved, it's generally important. But in security incidents or incidents in general, communication is crucial. In the example of the Titanic, Captain Smith ordered the first and second officers to, quote, put the women and children in the lifeboats and lower away. So some officers did just that. They lowered the lifeboats with empty seats because there were no women and children around. A bunch of men were standing on the ship that was about to sink. Others, on the other hand, took it in a more friendly, I don't know, way and put men in empty seats and saved those. Now, I want to wrap up with two resources. On the left is a magazine called Oceanos, which in this edition puts a lot of context and details into the sinking of the Titanic. It's actually quite interesting to read. And the book on the right, Agile Application Security by Laura Bell and others, goes into how agile teams, which most of us probably work in, can deal with security issues despite or because they are able to iterate quickly. Right, and eventually I want to thank a couple of folks who provided a bunch of input for this talk, Tom Eastman, Heidi Waterhouse, and several others of my colleague. I want to thank the folks from White October for giving me the opportunity to talk to you, and all of you for coming today. Thank you.